you have to have faith in Christ. You have to have faith in the Holy Spirit to sanctify you, set you apart. You see, the scripture shows these things on the day of Pentecost. The Holy Ghost came as a rushing sound, as of a mighty wind. Holy, 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 holy Ghost, holy, holy. Somebody, somebody, it's got to be something. So I still got sin in my flesh. Yeah. But the Spirit is holy. It gives you ability to control even the sinful flesh. It sets it apart. And it even quickens your flesh. It makes your flesh want to clap his hand and praise God. Isn't it something? It's so holy and it's so righteous and pure, it makes your mouth want to say, hallelujah. I mean, isn't it something? I mean, it's so righteous and it's so pure and it's so holy and so powerful, it makes you want to raise your hand and give God glory. And you can't realize that you've been changed and set apart and given a place in the kingdom. We are sitting in heavenly places. So you have to do some basic before the body can come together as a function, as a unit. You have faith in one another. You have to have some faith in yourself to be born into the body of Christ, into the family of God, as a son or daughter of God. This centurion said, Lord, I'm a man under authority. I understand authority. I used to hear my dad preach this a lot. And he was preaching this, he would go like, do that. I'm like, what are you talking about? I'm like, I'm really upset, but I can't explain. I'm like, to me, it was saying, you know something. If you ain't telling your children, you ain't telling them. Because he was like, the man said, I'm a man under authority, he would do this here. I'm just rolling his hand around. But in his house, when he said, kids, y'all go out there and dish that field up. And when you get to this, you take that harbor and harbor that field and you plant it. That was it. It was done. He would say, I want y'all on the other part of kids go over here and chop out by a day for this man to do his here. When he got through talking, what was to be done, he went to town to take care of business. It wasn't necessary. He came by need and he expected what he said to be done. He had rent houses around Helena, West Helena. And he understood and he had money in the bank. We didn't understand all of you. But he understood authority and he understood power. So when he read this, I'm like, looking at him like, you read. The centurion said, I'm a man under authority. And you go like this and this. I heard something in the bank. One day I went to the bank, the president of the bank was there, and I was talking to the president of the bank, like wanting to borrow some money or something. He said, and one of the men spoke to him, even Kirkwood agent. And the bank president said, yeah, this is the famous Kirkwood family. I'm like, what is he talking about? They had one, I remember one of my cousin, Cliff Williams, Cut Cliff we call him. He wanted me to work some of his land and rent about 20 acres or something like that. And he went to the president of the bank and he said to the president of the bank, he said, I ain't got time, I gotta go to the field and do something. Get this boy a loan for about $20,000 or something, because he gotta get work. The man said, okay, Mr. Cliff. So he had so many thousand acres of land. And he said, okay, Mr. Cliff, he had his money in there. And like, I'm looking like, you know, at the time I'm about 17 or something. And I'm learning things about things I don't know nothing about. Well, these men that had influence. And I'm watching what was happening. You know, you don't know, understand nothing about money or power and influence or wealth, and you know, you don't know nothing about it, or having people under you. You know, he would have people work for him, and I didn't know nothing about that. But when he would read, he would do this here. I guess he means a real term. What in the world are we talking about? And I've had some people hear me say, read this, and they don't know what that man talking about, just nothing. But if you was in the Roman army and you didn't do what he said do under that centurion, some heads was gonna roll. It would be some serious situation. You realize authority, you realize power. Look at what they did to Christ. And you realize the power of the Roman army, the Roman Empire, I mean to say. But this man recognized the empire that he was in. And he made the statement to Christ. He said, I also am a man under authority. An empire that do not compare to the kingdom of heaven. Power and authority that does not touch the greatness of the power of the kingdom of heaven, or the power of the Holy Spirit embodied in those born of the Holy Spirit. Position exaltation has not reached nowhere near the exaltation to be born into the family of God as a son of God, to really believe on him, to then be the power to come to be the sons of God. But this man recognized power in the Roman Empire. And he could sense that Christ had power like he had power with God. Christ had power with God like he had power in the Roman Empire. He said, you don't have to come to my house. I done heard the writing of the Jewish prophets. And I've heard of the prophet Moses and the great deed that were done. He wasn't a Jew. Jesus responded after he finished hearing what the message that this man had said. He said, verily I say unto you, I have not found so much faith in Israel. I mean, he took time to consider the greatness of the deeds that were done unto my people, chosen people. And he recognized his power. He recognized, I have power to just set for something to be, and it will be done. You know, many of us that are born the Holy Spirit can't do nothing. Take everything for granted. The big thing is we can skip around and dance a little bit. And we can shout it. We can, you know, it matters whether or not you hear truth. It matters because, see, truth comes in stages. There's steps in order to learning. I can teach and explain things like this, but you go turn around and listen to somebody tell you, faith is just believing, you just believe in your mind. You think you're going to hold on to what I'm saying? You think you're going to grow in faith in God? There's a growing process of growing in faith in God, but you turn around from the very definition and go listen to somebody tell you, faith is just believing, you just believe in something to be. And you think you're going to grow in the things I'm saying? The Bible says we sit in heavenly places. Do you think you're going to walk like a child of God? You think you're going to act like the apostle, do the deeds of the apostle? Mark wrote, as Christ says, go and make disciples. And these things shall follow them that believe. In my name, they shall cast out devils. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Those who believe what you say. Those who believe the gospel of me, that I took on the seed of Abraham and walked among you as a man. See, you know, it makes a difference to understand this. If one can't perceive Christ actually coming in human flesh and blood, that the Supreme Spirit of God, Son of God, took on the seed of Abraham, got inside of a man's seed, and was conceived of a woman, birthed into this world inside of a human flesh and blood body. If you can't perceive Christ doing that, how are you going to perceive Christ being born inside of you? How you can perceive the power? You can't see Christ walking in the flesh. How you going to see Christ in your flesh walking in you? You see, a child goes by role model and mimic. They look at mama who's in flesh and blood, daddy in flesh and blood, they realize what they can do. Daddy walk, I can walk, daddy talk, I learn to talk. And if you can't see Jesus, you born of him, born of Christ. But you can't realize him coming in the flesh But your man, like, I'm too sinful, my flesh too sinful for Christ to come inside and work through me. But Christ was working in sinful flesh, healing the sick, raising the dead, casting out demons, controlling it. But your mentality is that he can't do it through you, and you ain't, because you ain't perceiving him like you. And you might think that won't affect you.
And this is the gospel now.
Being denied. And you don't realize the effect it has on you. Christ took away the first, they may establish second. His death was for the end of the first step. You ain't under the law. You ain't under the Ten Commandments no more. Now you're under the Spirit of grace. You're born into the family of God. Elohim's very nature has been birthed inside of you. You are now a citizen of the kingdom of heaven through Christ's testament. Being born of the covenant of Christ is testament. But now, if you can't separate the body and the blood, you can't realize that you're under the law no more. And you hear people walk around saying, well, can't nobody keep all the law? You step on the end, you kill. You can't keep all the law, and everybody will come short of law and someone. And then you get the gospel. Then you started condemning yourself. Oh, you didn't know you was condemning yourself. Okay.
You didn't put that together.
The devil just played with you, right? Now, there's a logic to what Christ has done. There's a reason why he did the way he did it. The Bible says in Romans 8 and 3, he said, for what the law could not do, God sent his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh. And for sin, condemned sin in the flesh. Now, Christ came in sinful flesh to die instead of mankind dying. Redeemed our fathers back then, purchased them. I said redeemed, I mean he purchased them. Don't mean redeemed them all to go to heaven, but purchased them as healed. You want to get the redemption, as for life to be saved, you got to accept him. And he done bought everybody. He redeemed all your baddies that were living over 1900 years ago. He redeemed even the dead that were dead. And when he redeemed your dad that were living, he purchased you who were to be their offspring or will come to be born. But that don't mean that they all walk in heaven because he redeemed them or purchased them. He gave his life a ransom for man. You want to get this second redemption part? That's a matter of you being saved or you going to heaven. That means you got to accept him for having bought you, that he did buy you, purchase you, purchase your daddy would have went to hell. This is why I come in, why you baptize. Say, died instead of mankind dying back then. And when he bought your dad, he bought you. But for you to be redeemed and make it into heaven, your sins got to be washed away. You got to accept Christ and have faith in his blood to wash away your sins. Now there's faith in Christ's death for their sins under the first testament. There's a difference. You need to know that. He died for their sins. They were all to die. The length of blood atoned. But they were appointed to die. To die and to burn in hell. So Christ had to die in the place of man dying one Passover day. Death passed over the world and came on the firstborn Son of God. Now, you need to understand these things. You see, you're going to carry a condemnation. Talking about you still under the law. You're going to carry a condemnation talking about you'll be judged in the end of the world by whether or not you kept the Ten Commandments and the laws of Moses. And you're carrying a false condemnation because you ain't accepting the gospel. You ain't separating Christ's body and blood. You sit down in the communion, there's a separation, but you ain't accepting it. So there's a condemnation that you're carrying. You can't realize your sanctification. You can't realize now what has happened because you're refusing the gospel. So you're carrying this condemnation. Ain't nobody live right. Everybody gonna come short of the law. So you don't accept the gospel of Christ. Going along with traditional men. You can't walk in authority, therefore. Faith without a clear conscience results in shipwreck. So you held down by your own country. You don't understand how all these things connect. God took the time to put these things together. He done this logically, intellectually, and for a reason. There's a purpose behind. of the gospel. There's a reason behind this. Christ gave his blood for his brother testament after he was dead. There's a reason behind these things. So you can't walk rightly before God for your condemning yourself.